passion. The hobby is the people. Weekly news and interviews. It's your number one source. Sports Card Nation. The hobby is the people. Sports Card Nation.
Welcome to another jam-packed episode of the Sports Card Nation podcast, the show that brings you all the important news from the sports card hobby. We'll have some debates, opinions, new release schedules, and info. Plus, we'll also discuss the sports that so directly affect the hobby we all love. We'll mix in an occasional gambling tip or two, throw in some life stuff, and bring you great guest interviews from the hobby and sports dignitaries. And if you're good listeners, we may even give away a few things now and then. Now, here's the guy who wanted the cards and not the gum, John Newman.
Answering the bell for the 46th time. I'm John Newman, here with the Sports Card Nation podcast. Excited today. I'm excited every Friday we do the show, but the debut of the Monster Energy interview guest line. We're going to have Lou Papa Jr. from Sports Card Exchange on that line. It'll be the answer to a trivia question, the first ever guest on the Monster Energy guest line. And I want to thank Monster on the corporate level for, helping us out there. We'll be giving away some stuff as things come in that regard. I don't want to say too much. I'm not sure about everything we're going to get, but we'll see how that plays out. But we'll be giving out some stuff as it gets here. So Louis Papa Jr. is going to be on the show. You ever seen his collection? Check out his social media accounts. He's got just an insane inventory. Very candid interview. He's going to share with you his opinion on the current events of the hobby. And you know, we all know about the grading and trimming. And he's gonna be very up in the forefront and tell you that he was directly affected on a few of his cards. He was fortunate not to get financially really sunk by it, but he had a scare, and he's going to share that with you. And a credit to him. You know, some people may not want to share stuff like that and put themselves out there like that, but Lewis is gracious enough to do that, and I appreciate it. I think you'll find the interview fairly fascinating with how he goes about stuff about how that recent events gave him that scare and affected him how he even does things now. He's had to pivot and change kind of his approach to things. So he'll talk about that. Glad to have him on. A really good down-to-earth guy. I want to shout out Rocketbook. Rocketbook is a company I found them on Kickstarter years ago. They made a notebook that you write in with a friction pens from Pilot, and when it gets filled up and you want to refresh it, the original one you would put in the microwave with a half glass a half mug of water for a couple minutes, and it would erase all the ink inside, and you start over again with new notes, and you could do that 5 times. Well, they got a new line. It's not really new. It's been out a few years, but the Fusion line, and now their notebooks, you don't have to microwave them. They're basically dry erase boards in notebook form. If you rub your hand against it, you can't get it off, but if you get kind of a towel that they give you, a small towel and a little moisture, you can erase it. And I'm using it. And I kind of shouted them out that I love their products online. Not even trying to real just say thank you for these inventions. You know, rather than have 10, 15 notebooks just in a bookcase, I use these. And they saw my post and contacted me behind the scenes, said, hey, send us your address. We'll send you some stuff. And I got a package in the mail a couple of days ago. I posted on social media about it. They sent me a really cool mug, some sunglasses. They sent me a Fusion notebook and a mini Fusion notebook, which is really cool. It's like a little notepad. And again, these are erasable, so they last a lifetime. You know, the microwavable ones only last 5 uses. These you can use over and over again. And, you know, when you look at it, it looks just like regular pen and regular ink. And when you want to wipe out that page, you just moisten that rag they give you, wipe it down, and it's clear to take new notes. I use their products to do a lot of my show note-taking and stuff pertaining to the show, but I use it for other things other than that. And just a great invention. And so Rocketbook, I want to thank you right on this podcast for sending that great package over. You didn't have to do that, but you did, and I appreciate it. You got a user for life. And if you've never seen their products, folks, check their stuff out. It's really kind of a crazy invention, and really change how you kind of do business. You can use it for personal use. You can use it at work. I do both, and it's just a great, great product. Oh, one other thing I forgot to mention with the Rocketbook products, they have an app too, and you can designate by a logo on the box on the bottom of each page. You kind of put a mark through that logo, and it that tells it where that when you take a picture with your phone, that will scan that photo to wherever you designate it to go. The cloud, OneDrive, Google OneDrive, certain email addresses. It's just a great feature, very productive, and again, love their stuff. One more quick promotional note. Programming note, myself and Drew Herndon from Let Me Get That Podograph have done 2 episodes. We do a new live podcast, webcast, if you will, Sunday nights, 9:30. The show is called Roughing the Passer. You see both of our ugly mugs live on the screen. It's interactive. We can bring you on the show if you want to debate us, either disagree with us or agree with us on something. As the name suggests, Roughing the Passer. It's about the week in football and specifically really keying in on Sunday's games. We make our picks for the next week during the week, and we kind of keep standings. I'll just say he's in early trouble against me, but a lot of season still left, so you know, still some sand in that hourglass. He could possibly catch up. I don't think he will if I can do a little trash talking. But it's a great new show. We probably both have faces for radio, but we get to break the internet with them. Go to Facebook and like the search Roughing the Passer. Like that page, and you'll get notifications when we go live, which is every Sunday night. 9:30. We go about an hour, hour and a half, depending, and it's great. You're welcome to come on and interact with us, and we go through all the day's events in football, talk about stock up, stock down with you know, different players and performances, and a little bit of cards always seem to sneak in every week, even though it's really geared to the sports end of the football. So hope you like that page, Roughing the Passer. Hope you watch the show. We're having a lot of fun doing it. Each week we're getting even a little bit better with it. So Roughing the Passer, 9:30 Eastern Time on Sunday nights.
Here we go.
It's time for What's Cracking. As the basketball preseason starts to heat up in anticipation for the regular season, All the NBA basketball products are starting to come out slowly but surely. And a lot of high prices involved on the ticket price of those products, mainly, as we all know, due to Zion Williamson mania. You know, I think you got to navigate through these waters carefully and look at these individual products and see. You know, I'm one of those guys that like to watch a little bit, get open first, kind of see what's coming out, how these boxes are loaded or not loaded. And I think you really kind of have to do that with the price of some of these basketball products and determine, you know, which one gives you the best chance to really do all right for get the most bang for your buck, as they say. And, you know, I think it's a pretty good rookie class besides Zion. He looks very good early here in the preseason as well. Looks up to the billing, as they say. But again, it's still early. And, you know, it's going to be a very expensive basketball year if you want to try to open everything. I think that'll be tricky. I don't know if that's smart, but it's fun, that's for sure. And so I think it's basketball is going to be where you pick your spots, see what products are more productive than others. And whether you're a basketball collector or what they want to coin, basketball investor or flipper, you got some decisions you have to weigh and make with a lot of these new releases. Less than a week away from the 2019 Topps Update Baseball, and all you have to do is say Topps Update to get a reaction from most baseball collectors. It's highly anticipated every year. A lot of that stems, as we all know, from the Mike Trout phenomenon with Update. And there's been many great years with Update. Last year, actually, not too bad. This year, at least right now, you know, things change. Even the 2018 Update kind of was a late bloomer. It's kind of rocketed up more recently than when it was first released. And, you know, you see people posting on social media, still finding them in clearance racks if they're lucky and fortunate enough to do it. But on the secondary market, obviously the price point has went up due to the rookies in it. The 2019 edition is not real rookie heavy in traditional terms as many years before. Many of the better rookies, the Alonzos, Guerrero Jr., made their way into the Series 2. So I got a feeling the 2019 update's not going to be as popular or maybe valuable, if you will, as the traditional update releases prior. And I think the top series 2 and will be kind of the update of 2019, if you will. But, you know, it's still update. It still carries that connotation to it. You know, I know more people are probably going to probably buy some and stock it away than probably in past years in anticipation that there'll be an increase as certain young players start to produce and perform. And not that that's a bad idea, but I don't know how the 2019 update is going to fare in comparison with 2018 and some of these other years. So on paper, if you will, it doesn't look quite as promising as prior years. Let's talk about the phenomenon known as Baker Mayfield. In early season or even in the off season and the end of last season, Baker Mayfield price levels were reaching very, very high proportions and very comparable to the MVP known as Patrick Mahomes. And we all know now Baker not playing very well here in the early season. And on Monday night in prime time, 8 for 22 for 100 yards, a couple picks, got sacked and benched. And, you know, a lot of people are panic selling. And, you know, someone asked me direct message. You know, I probably should have saved it for the wide open segment. I guess I'm kind of doing that now. But they asked me, you know, is it a good time to buy? And it might be. I mean, prices are coming down. I might wait. They haven't come down to crazy, crazy low levels. But if you believe that, you know, he's just going through a rough patch, then it might be a good time to buy. If you believe last year's performance is more indicative than this year's performance. But what tends to happen in football, something I like to think I know a little bit about, is, you know, these teams watch film. They start to notice tendencies with young players, especially at the quarterback position, and they start to game plan, obviously, and fare better after seeing that film. And I think a little bit of that's going on. Baker's going to have to make some adjustments to his game. Can he do it? Sure. A lot of quarterbacks have. A lot of quarterbacks have had maybe not a great second year and went on to have a great career. So, I mean, if you're panic selling, you're entitled to do that. I don't think the sky is falling yet. But, you know, if you look at if this continues and he doesn't really play well most of the year, you really have to start to wonder. And it's that whole, you know, Cleveland Browns quarterback, is he going to be another name on that list that showed a little flash for a year? I don't think that's the case. I think he's going to be okay and get through this rough patch of play. But at the same time, I don't know if he's going to be the player we saw last year that set a couple rookie passing records, almost 30 touchdowns, and without being the starter to start the year. I thought he caught maybe a little lightning in the bottle. I think he's still a good player, you know, but when you're talking about investing or putting a lot of money into him, he's definitely fun to watch. I don't know if smart money goes in that direction. Well, if you have an extra $20K lying around, maybe check in your couch cushions. November 27th is coming. What's November 27th? The 2019 Transcendent Baseball release. Everybody's favorite to crack open. Definitely fun to watch being cracked open. Some crazy stuff, as we all know, comes out of that product. This year, the man of the moment, if you will, in that product is Ken Griffey Jr. Last year was Mike Trout. So there will be a party where you'll get to meet and interact with the kid, Ken Griffey Jr. It's the 30th anniversary of his rookie season in 1989 here in 2019. So good choice on Topps' part. Like I said, $20,000, November 27th. My birthday is November 24th. If anyone wants to like get together and buy me a gift, a case of this would be more than acceptable. But, crazy product, fun to open, fun to see some of that historic stuff come out of that. And I'll definitely be watching. I'll be honest, which I've never bought into a break. I've come close a few times, never pulled the trigger. One of these days, one of these years, I should say, I might actually do it. Will this be the year? I don't know. I like Ken Griffey Jr. quite a bit. So maybe I take $150, $200 and buy a spot in a break and cross my fingers. But definitely one of my, probably my favorite product to watch, you know, videos or watch live breaks of. It's definitely crazy what comes out of that and see what people hit.
Sports Card Nation podcast is your weekly hobby and sports podcast, now on 10 platforms: iTunes, Google Podcast, Stitcher, Spotify, Radio Public, Anchor, Pocket Cast, Breaker, Castbox, and Overcast. Listen to in over 26 countries globally, Sports Card Nation podcast is one of the most interactive podcasts around, providing great content, giveaways, and some of the hobby's best interview guests without time constraints. Thousands can't be wrong. We want to thank all the wonderful listeners around the world, all our great guests, and our tremendous sponsors for making us what we are today. As always, without you, there is no us.
Excuse me. I'd like to ask you a few questions.
All right, time for our wide open segment where you, the listener, can ask us questions or me questions, either about the hobby or personal or what have you. So these are two holdovers from the other week that I couldn't get in. So I kind of liked them, so I'll run with them today. They're both actually from our Instagram side of things. And the first one is from ddenny84 on Insta. And he asked me, you don't post a lot of personal cards on your podcast social medias. Is there a reason for that? Well, ddenny, not really. It's a good question. I don't know really why I don't post more. I do post some. It's not like I don't post any. A lot of some of the PC cards I've posted recently. For those that may not know, I have a Newman sports card size. That's basically kind of the business side of cards that I buy and sell and that sort of thing. So I kind of tend to kind of keep the two things separated. I'll be honest with you, since the show's been doing very well lately, I've kind of I want to say slacked off a little bit or slowed down on keeping the Newman sports card side up. I still do sales and website sales and eBay and ComC and all that. So I feel like I try to separate the two and keep them separate. I think that's the reason why. But I was thinking about this the other day. I am going to probably start posting more cards from my inventory on the podcast side of things. Nick Bosa had a crazy night the other night, and I have a number to five, gold national VIP auto, and I kind of mentioned the game he had and posted it. So I don't like to post a lot on the podcast side. It's almost like you're flexing a little bit, but I guess not. And if people have asked me to post a little bit more of what I actually have. And so I think I'll pick my spots and probably do that a little more than I have up until now. Next question, also from Instagram, username CardinalFan72. And the question says, John, you mentioned a lot of other podcasts during your podcast. Why do you do that? Don't you see them as competition? I don't mean that in a bad way. I listen to other podcasts, and I've had those podcasts host on this very show and vice versa. So I think for the most part, most of us, get along. This show has really, kind of taken off. I don't want to get into a humble brag, but the show's doing very well now. And, even on a little bit with corporate sponsorship. So I try to get along with everybody. I'll even retweet other people's podcast posts when they release in an episode, or I try to. I'm sure I miss some. I listen, as I've said on this very show, 4 to 5. I've had them hosts on the show. This hobby is huge. There's millions of people who are in this hobby. I think we all know that. And there's thousands of people who listen to sports card podcasts. And I'll venture a very good guess that most people listen to more than just one. They might have a favorite. I give you that. But I think a collector or an investor or whatever you want to label someone in the hobby, if they're listening to hobby podcasts, they're probably listening 2, 3, 4, maybe even more. Myself probably range between 4 to 8 at different times. I'll jump on and catch an episode of a good percentage of them, truthfully. And I respect all the other podcasters out there and what they do. And I'll tell you this. I'll be very going off on a little soapbox here, but I think it's important. Not really doing a podcast before this one. I was a guest on a sports podcast where all I had to do was show up and banter with the hosts for 2 to 3 hours on Friday. That's easy to just show up, go in the studio, and mic's on, and here we go. You know, I mean, I want to say it's easy, but it's a lot easier than doing your own show. And these other podcasters, if they're listening to this, they'll know exactly what I'm talking about. And, you know, you may hear, you know, if it's an hour episode, and in my case, an hour and a half, 2 hours sometimes, you know, you hear that length of the episode and you think we just kind of, you know, turn the computer, turn the mic on, and just rant on. And some of that's a little bit true. I mean, that's what we do. But, you know, I myself broadcast in segments all during the week. I edit it. You got guests you got to call and hook up with and connect and coordinate a time and to do interviews. You got to research, do your research. So while the end user might hear that 1 hour of podcast or that hour and a half of podcast in Sports Card Nation's case, you know, my hour and a half podcast probably has, and I'm not, you know, I'm not trying to pat myself on the back, 7, 8, maybe 9 hours worth of work into it to actually produce the end result of that hour and a half podcast. And if there are any of the other shows listening to this right now, they know exactly what I'm talking about. And I know exactly the effort they're putting in. So I'm competitive by nature. I played sports from the age of 5. I coached, as I've said previously, high school sports on the varsity level, baseball and football. So yeah, there's an inner drive. But that competitiveness is more with myself, folks, to be quite honest with you. I want to do a better show than I did the last show. You know, I want 46 to be better than 45. I wanted 45 to be better than episode 45. So I don't know. It's just so much I want to beat this show or beat that show. I like those, the majority of the other shows. So I respect what they do because I do it. I know the work and the details that go into producing these shows where maybe some don't. And maybe some of the listeners do too, and I appreciate that. I'm sure they do as well. But no, I think there's a general, with me, I can only speak for myself now, so this is me talking. I generally respect all the other podcasters, especially in the sports card realm. I know what kind of grit and muscle goes into getting these episodes out, especially the weekly shows. To be honest with you, it's hard to do a weekly podcast, and you know, you're finished, you're done with one, and you're already starting to prep for the following week. So I try to get along with everyone. I respect everybody, as long as that respect is mutual. I try to promote as many other shows. This ocean's big enough for all of us to sail on, as I like to say. And so that's my feeling. Again, I'm only speaking for myself here. So I'll mention podcasts at various times without blinking an eye. It doesn't matter. And, you know, the show has generated money. I'm not going to lie. But it's not my real job. I have a job I work 50 hours a week on. So, you know, it's not my, I'm not paying my mortgage, as they say, with the show. Does it bring a little extra income? And you know, sure. And I try to put that back into the show as well and do some giveaways and that sort of thing. It's why we don't ask really for donations or help to produce the show, and I really plan on never to do that. It's kind of a pet peeve of mine, quite frankly, when I hear other shows maybe do that, not just sports card ones, but just in general. But I get it. There's costs involved too. That's a two-sided coin. But no, it won't stop me. You'll hear me mention shows again and host by name or have them on and vice versa. like I said, plenty of water in this ocean for all the boats to be on. And you know, I listen to 4, 5, 6 on a regular basis. And I actually listen to more, maybe not on a regular basis, but there's probably a good 8 or 9 that I catch either regularly or just some episodes here and there. So that's my take. That's my soapbox I just went on a rant on. And there you go.
Hey guys, this is Matt from Firebox Sports Card Cases. In our hobby, there are so many different ways to collect. From group breaks to singles, Hall of Fame vintage to prospect autos. No matter how you collect, you place a premium on your cards. With our durable aluminum frames, precision cut foam inserts, locking closures, and detachable shoulder straps, Firebox will be the only case worthy of your collection. Firebox offers 3 unique cases so you can choose the option that best fits your collecting style. Whether you want the most graded capacity, the versatility to seamlessly switch between raw and graded cards, or hands-free buying, selling, and trading with our first-of-its-kind collector's hardshell backpack, Firebox has a solution for you. There is plenty of fire to pull in today's hobby, but the hobby isn't in the junk era anymore. So why are you still storing your collection in boxes made of junk? Go to fireboxcases.com today and use promo code SCNPOD to get 10% off your order of a premium case to reflect your premium cards. That's fireboxcases.com, promo code SCNPOD to start bringing the heat with you wherever you go.
Excited to have my next guest on the newly minted, first guest on the newly minted Monster Energy guest line. First week that they've backed at and sponsored the guest portion of the show. And so he'll always have that, no matter what happens, the next gentleman's always going to have the distinction of being the first one in that, you know, answer to a trivia question, if you will. But I'm just kidding. But it is true. It's followed him for a while. He's got, I don't know how other way to say it, just an insane inventory, a very intelligent guy, and enthusiastic about what he does. And I'm glad he's finally come on. So without wasting any more time, Lou Papa Jr., Sports Card Exchange, welcome.
Hey, thank you, John. I appreciate you reaching out and having me on the show. I'm really happy to be here. Thank you.
Well, we appreciate it. Like I said in the intro there, long-winded, if you will, but, you know, the inventory that you have, it's just, it's fun to look at and see and you know, the cards. One thing about your collection, you know, whether it's current day and then you do vintage as well. I know, you know, as a Steeler fan, I'm not a huge fan personally of them, but you can't argue with the success. I know you have quite the Tom Brady inventory, Connor McDavid. I mean, and that's just, you know, a tip of the iceberg. You know, you don't have to go back to, you know, the very beginning, but kind of, you know, how did you get into how did you get from, you know, 0 to 60 to the high end portion of the hobby?
Sure. No, I appreciate the question. I think I'm hoping that I can relate, you know, to many, many of your listeners and many other hobbyists. I mean, cards have been in my life probably since I was about 10, 12 years old. I've always been a big sports fan, and way back in the day, I certainly enjoyed, you know, reading the box scores each day and following, you know, I'm originally from Philadelphia, so yep. I was following all my Philly teams, you know, just little by little, you know, I guess, you know, maybe your parents take you to the store and you pick up a pack of cards and then you start trying to get your, you know, your favorite players. And, you know, certainly back then cards were certainly, you know, a great deal different than what they are now. But I sort of fell in love with the whole, you know, buying them, looking at them, stacking, you know, by teams. I mean, I used to do, you know, like little things like, you know, as the cards would come out of the pack, I would separate them by teams.
Yep.
And then as the, I'd take the newspaper and then I would kind of see like what teams were in first place all the way down to last place, and then just kind of stack my little sets based on, you know, like if the Yankees were in first, then the Yankees pile would move to the top, you know, followed by the Red Sox and, you know, everybody else. So yeah. You know, it started with a very innocent, you know, love of the games and then the teams. And then it slowly but surely, you know, my dad would take me to the local shows, you know, at different malls and things like that. So, you know, I recognize the verbiage I'm using now probably doesn't apply to some of the younger kids that are in the hobby now when you're starting to talk about, like, you know, reading newspapers and going to malls for shows. but that's what it was, yeah. You know, 30-plus years ago. And then, you know, and I think, like a lot of other people, you know, when you get to college, you know, you kind of fall away from it for a little bit. And, you know, the same thing happened to me. I think that I was into it, you know, really aggressively for 4, 5, 6 years when I was younger. Went away to school, you know, got away from it, you know, for several years. And then I think as my, you know, career started to develop and I was making a little bit more money, mm-hmm. It enabled me to start to get back to the hobby a little bit and kind of collect maybe the way I'd always dreamed of as a kid. You know, when my whole life's ambition was to open up a card store, you know, and just do that for a living.
Yeah.
And then it just, over the last 3, 4, 5 years, it just kind of took off, you know, as, you know, I guess as things have amplified here in the hobby with prices and such. And, you know, it's been quite the journey. I never really would have imagined where I am today, just in terms of some of the cards that I do have.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't set out, you know, to do it this way, I guess is really what I'm trying to say.
Yep. Well, you have. I know, you know, one of the goals I've set this year is to open less wax. I know I don't want to put you on the spot, but I guess, do you open any newer stuff at all, or have you kind of phased that sort of out to focus on just acquiring key cards you're trying to get?
I would say that I've never been much of a wax ripper, you know, certainly not over the last handful of years. A couple things that I did buy, I was chasing the Connor McDavid Young Gun auto buyback. I thought that was a really cool piece. So I did go to my local LCS here, you know, and bought a bunch of SP Authentic cards,
yep.
You know, to try to catch some. I didn't get any there, which was fine, but, you know, I did pick up some other cool autos that came out of the boxes. And when I go to shows, you know, my son enjoys, you know, getting a box or two, you know, at each show that I bring him to. So, you know, like just this past weekend, we were in the at the local show here in Nashville. It was good turnout. There was like 80 tables. I bought him a couple of boxes, one football, one basketball. But really 99% of my time, effort, money, all goes into just buying either private collections or individual key cards that I want for myself.
Now, do you get a lot of calls or texts from people? Hey, you know, so-and-so, my father maybe passed away. He left cards, or, you know, I have a collection. You get a lot of those where, let's be honest. I get them myself where a lot of times it's from that junk wax era, and you have to kind of be the bearer of bad news, you know, that was a period in cards where there was overproduction and what was once thought to be, you know, going to be worth a mint, not so much anymore. Do you get a lot of those type of calls?
I would say yes. I do get a fair amount of messages, either through Facebook or Instagram, or through my website. And you know, truthfully, there's been two of those calls that, you know, have really led to a substantial find.
Yeah.
So I would say that, every call is worth taking.
Yeah.
I enjoy speaking to collectors. I've had a couple of people come to my house, you know, where they just showed me some pictures online and then just came over. And even if I didn't buy it, I mean, we spent, you know, 2-3 hours together, just talking about cards and different things that we liked. And, you know, so, I mean, it's really fun, you know, to look at almost anything, even from, you know, the mass-produced era. I mean, I really like that era because that's what I grew up in.
And yep.
While it's not necessarily, you know, the hottest thing on the market or anything like that, but, you know, with the advent of grading and pop counts, you know, it has been able to put a premium on, you know, some really high end players that, you know, that you and I had the privilege of, you know, growing up to, you know, like your Tony Gwynn's and John Elway's and things like that, that otherwise, you know, might not get the attention, you know, that those players deserve.
Yep. No, I agree with you. And, you know, like you said, I think you summed it up real good. For us, we're similar in age. That was the wheelhouse, and it's always an error, regardless of value, that we're going to look fondly back on. And I have no, like you, you know, when I get those calls, I tend to talk to people about it, and brings back those memories all over again, even though, you know, the DeLorean's not real. It's probably the closest thing you can get to going back, you know. So, it's that error for me and for, you know, I don't want to speak for you, but I think for you too, that is why we're still around doing cards even today. So you can't forget that past.
I absolutely love that era. I still have the large majority of the cards that I bought as a kid.
I was going to ask you that, is, you know, was it the classic story? They all got thrown out and you restarted, but you just said you actually have quite a bit of your original stuff from then.
Yeah. There's a couple of pieces that I've subsequently traded or sold, you know, since I've kind of gone from more of a private collector to, you know, a little bit more public, you know, through social media. But truthfully, the stuff that I really, really like that I don't look at enough. I mean, I still have all the, like, the old Topps traded sets. I still have, you know, like the Fleer updates and, you know, I mean, I used to try to buy like one Topps set or Donruss set per year, just so that I would have, you know, like each set from, say, 1983 to like 1995 or whatever it was, you know, that I was doing. And, I mean, I still have them. And, you know, when we moved to Nashville almost 3 years ago, when we were packing up, I couldn't find my cards, trying to figure out, like, man, what did I do with them? You know, did I give them to my younger brother? Did I leave them at my parents' house all these years? And then, sure enough, as we started filtering through the house, my wife found, like, this big tub, you know, of all the cards and all the sets, and still in their original boxes and everything. And, like, I mean, it brought a tear to my eye. I mean, I could feel the goosebumps, you know, coming on my arms and on my legs, because it just brings you to a time mentally where, you know, things were just so different, but yet so enjoyable. And, you know, like, you're this wide eye sort of, you know, precocious kid being like, wow, you know, I'm touching like an off-centered Steve Garvey rookie, you know, but like, it was just the coolest thing ever. I mean, you know, I had like these banged up Bob Gibson rookies, you know, that would only be a 3 or a 4 today. But, you know, back then you're like, good gosh. I mean, you know, I spent $40, $60, whatever it was, you know, maybe more. And, you know, at the time that was like all the money in the world.
Yep. And it brings you back to, you know, a point in our lives where you really didn't have a lot of the worries you have in today's day and age, you know, just kind of carefree and hanging, you know, with friends and collecting cards. And, you know, as you grow up, you realize you do appreciate that in the moment, but you don't appreciate as much knowing what you know as an older adult, you know. And it kind of brings you back to that point in your life where, you know, there wasn't a lot of worries then, you know. And it's the closest you'll get, I guess, to really going back there. And you know, it's nice to hear you say, I have a 19-year-old son and he collects a little bit and we do some stuff. And it's nice to hear you still share that, you know, with your own kids. So it kind of just gets passed down, you know, to the next generation and whatnot.
I'm hopeful, you know, that my kids will take an interest, you know, as time moves along. I sort of like a slow grind with them, but they do. You know, my son is 11. He'll be turning 12 in the not too distant future here. My daughter is 6, and you know, but they enjoy going to a store with me. You know, they enjoy, you know, I think they kind of get it that they're going to get like a present or such. And so, like, even today, like, they we didn't have a chance to open the boxes that I had bought for him at the show this weekend. So we were, right before you called, I was telling them what I was doing, and then they wanted to open the boxes. So I'm eager to see what who they got and, you know, what they're going to do with the cards. And, you know, I kind of let them put them in sleeves and, you know, and enjoy them. So hopefully they got something that they liked.
Yeah, and personally, I love hearing stories like that. I was turned on to the hobby with my grandfather, you know, buying me a 1979 Topps pack. The fourth card in, you know, I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York. The fourth card in was a Reggie, and at that time, that, you know, he was New York and Mr. October, and that was it for me. And here we are, you know, 40 years later, literally, and I'm doing this and involved in cards still. And
yeah, absolutely. I mean, and I'm sure we can apply that to, you know, lots of different things in life. But you know, at the same time, I'm really grateful to see the enthusiasm of just the younger guys in the hobby. You know, meaning younger than me. You know, 25, 30, 35 even. You know, they bring great passion, great excitement, really leading forces in the hobby moving forward as far as using social media and, you know, the interconnectivity of it. So, you know, from that standpoint, you know, I continue to learn and evolve, and I'm really grateful for, you know, those fellas that, you know, spend some time with me and tell me about what they're doing. And, you know, so I do think that the evolution of the hobby will expand it for the better going forward, even if, you know, you don't have as many, quote, true collectors, you know, as there were maybe, say, 30, 40 years ago.
Now, you know, I'm not in the financial realm. That's what you do for work. I do invest in stocks and bullion and that sort of thing. I like to think it maybe gives me an advantage when I do purchase stuff and kind of put it away, if you will. Maybe a little bit more patient because of that other aspect of those things. You know, you do that for a living. Do you think that gives you sort of a different perspective or even an advantage when it comes to the hobby as far as, you know, what you purchase and look for and evaluate and that sort of thing?
I think from a different perspective, yes, absolutely. I mean, I think the way I evaluate cards and what I want to buy and what I want to sell is very closely tied to, you know, how I think about investments and long-term planning. I'm not so sure it gives me any real advantage per se. You know, I think that if anything, it probably makes me a bit more deliberate and conservative.
Yeah.
You know, I think of cards certainly as a high risk alternative asset class. However, within that structure, I do tend to buy, you know, sort of, I think what most people would think of as more of like blue chip, you know, sort of higher end things that, you know, will have a little bit of longer term sustainable value, where I don't have to sit there and look at the box scores each day anymore to see what, you know, some of the prospects or the second year guys are doing, you know, and things like that, where it literally seems to be driving prices up or down on a, you know, maybe a weekly or a monthly basis.
Mm-hmm.
I think that, you know, the guys that are doing it, you know, in the Bowman Chrome and, you know, in some of the prospecting that'll happen with, you know, each of the four sports, you know, tend to be much more aggressive, you know, than I would be. Like I said, I think it definitely gives me a very unique perspective, you know, especially when trying to evaluate what's real and what's not, as certain price points are being hit, you know, for different players. But I don't necessarily think it gives me an advantage per se.
Yeah, no, I agree. And you know, for me, with what I do, and not that it's, I don't do that, that's kind of side investment and whatnot. I just think for me, I've learned to be patient and not to, you know, maybe panic or move stuff and that sort of thing. You know, I had a card store myself from 92 to 96, and someone asked me what was the biggest mistake, or if I could go back and do it over again, what would I change? And I knew the answer right away. And for me, when I had the card store, you know, 92, 96, like I said, I was 20 to 24. And I don't know really why, but there were certain cards during that time where I got too attached to. So I didn't, you know, put them out, and I didn't sell them. And I had too many of those, let's just say. And as I've gotten older, not that I don't care about them, but I've learned to, like, not, you know, get too attached to him, if you will. And I mean, how do you navigate through that? Do you have cards where you say, man, I don't ever see me moving this or trading this or you know, do you ever have those kind of thoughts go through your, you know, with your inventory?
I think I've had a couple of, and I have a couple of pieces now that it would really just, it would take something to really, something would really have to wow me, you know, to, in order to move them. And I think that because of the stuff that I have, you know, that you're alluding to here, you know, those guys are already retired, you know, their legacy is cemented. So I don't really see any downside, you know, to holding, you know, for the super long term, unless I were to get something, you know, that would just be really, really unique. With that said, otherwise, I think the answer is pretty much no. I think that the fun in the hobby for me, it really is, you know, there's the hunt and the chase to, you know, to bring something in that you didn't think you could get or do.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's, you know, the best card of a certain player or completing, you know, a set or a subset, you know, like those things are really, really cool. But, you know, but then in order to, you know, really be able to aspire to, you know, to touch and have a lot of, you know, really cool cards, I think the more that I've opened my mind, you know, to deals, you know, whether it be trades or, you know, some kind of combination of cash and cards, you know, it's really opened my mind, you know, in terms of like how to diversify, you know, my card holding, you know, quite a bit. I mean, at one point I had 4 Brady championship ticket cards, you know, but after they won the Super Bowl, there was a guy that, you know, sort of made me an offer I couldn't refuse. You know, so now, you know, I've gone from 4 to 1, but the deal that he gave me, you know, was something that, I mean, I'm not independently or infinitely wealthy, you know, meaning like, you know, at some point you got to continue to earn and, you know, and save some money. So it's one of those things where you're like, wow, that's just a lot of money, you know, and a lot of good value. So, you know, I took it and, you know, subsequently, I mean, you know, I ultimately reinvested some stuff into, you know, Jordan or Mantle and Willie Mays. But then, you know, you take a little bit of the extra money and, you know, you do something cool with your wife and kids, and then you throw a few bucks in the bank.
Yep. Have you ever done a deal or trade cash or just a sale and really kind of had like seller's remorse, or, you know, you ever second guessed anything you've done, or you thought out pretty much?
Yeah, I mean, I would hope that almost everybody would answer that question yes, just because I feel like it's almost like, you know, like if anybody bets on sports and you have one of those moments where, you know, like you take this bad beat, you know, and then this other team comes back in and, you know, covers the point spread or what have you. I mean, yes. I mean, the short answer is yes. I mean, there's been, I've probably made 2 or 3 deals that, you know, with the benefit of perfect hindsight, I'd have never made those again.
Yeah.
But, and, you know, I lost, you know, significantly on the transaction.
Mm-hmm.
But what I will say is, but when that happens, I have to admit that my level of concentration and wanting to really bear down and do better, you know, has improved because of those transactions. And I think since that point in time, you know, I've been really blessed with, you know, different opportunities and different transactions and, you know, different card price appreciation, you know, that's more than made up for it. And I mean, my commitment level to the hobby got stronger because I was lazy. I mean, the reason why I screwed up those deals was my fault. I mean, like I was lazy. I didn't do the homework. You know, so, you know, it just made me look a little deeper within and saying, come on, man, like you can't just go throwing money out the door like that.
Yep. Well, I appreciate you answering that honestly. You know, I'm not sure everyone will. And I think you said it best. I think if you ask everyone that's in the hobby that question, I think everyone would say yes, or they're probably being, like you said, maybe not a little bit disingenuous. And like you said, for you, you took those moments and you it made you focus even more and just hone what you do to a different level. So that's always obviously a positive out of it. What percentage, Lou, would you say? I know you have a lot of graded, incredible graded stuff. What percentage would you say is of what your inventory is graded to not graded to raw?
I mean, it's probably, like, if you count, like, all my old sets and things like that that I've just kept throughout the years, then, my percentage raw would be much, much higher, than my percentage.
Well, let me ask you a different way, not to cut you. I guess key cards rather than like sets and full sets, just individual cards of significance, if you will.
Yeah, no, that's fine. I've been able to acquire a fair number of cards raw, but I enjoy getting my cards graded because I like them, getting them encapsulated, and I like the idea of, the safety and continuity of it. So I would say it's probably very close to 100%.
Okay. Wow. All right. I'm someone that submits cards for grading. I don't know how many, probably 400 or 500 slab cards. We obviously know what's going on in the hobby now. I know, obviously, at 100%, it's a very big part of what you do and what you have. I'm just curious. I'll put you on the spot to, your take or your opinion on what's going on. Where do you see the grading industry going or evolving, and how does, we go forward with what's going on currently?
Yeah, I mean, look, I guess we're in October, so this is about month 7 or so. Mm-hmm. I think since the guys on Blowout started to uncover some of the things that have been the unscrupulous stuff that's been going on in the hobby, I think I've been pretty vocal and transparent about how I've been caught up in it.
Yeah.
So I don't always buy graded. Like I said, a lot of the stuff I get is raw and then I turn it into graded.
Yeah.
Even if they come back sevens or eights or nines, it is what it is. But unfortunately, I've had four cards, I believe, that have been outed. I've been sort of referring to them as scarlet letter cards because, each one I really, really liked the cards.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently, there's a reason why they looked as good as they did.
Yeah.
So I am grateful, to the guys that are putting in that kind of work, to put the list out there, put the pictures out there. I've been in touch with a couple of those guys, and I mean, just, between you, me, and your audience right now, I've had to return 4 cards, and it's been totaled over $50,000.
Yep.
Wow. With the largest one being $19,000. I think I posted that I had a really nice PSA 8 Bob Cousy rookie from the 57 top set.
Yep.
I had 2 PSA 8 Jim Brown rookies from the 58 Topps football set. So those were just 3 off the top of my head that I can remember. And all of those were anywhere from, 8,000 to 19,000 or something to that effect. But so again, I for anyone that's listening that, has been doing that work, I do want them to know that they have my sincerest appreciation. And, it has helped me, and I'm hoping that it continues to help others. But I just, from a collector's perspective, I'm just so disappointed because they were cards that I was really, really excited about. And I also hope that, for all the other collectors out there and things like that may have had to go through what I have, it's just, as wonderful as it is, that information has come out. It's just, it's also equally as disappointing because you feel like, oh man, like these are like impossible to find cards, in these kinds of conditions. And
mm-hmm.
So, you're a little crestfallen. When you're trying to pick up certain things, and accumulate, multiple rookies for certain guys that you think are just, impossible to find. So, you know, so that's kind of where I was from an emotional perspective, you know, relating to all of it. You know, look, I mean, I'm not thrilled about what's happening, and I've tried to help out where I can, you know, by putting myself out there a little bit and saying, hey, look, this is what's happened to me. I've used the data that's available, you know, from what the fellows on Blowout are putting in, and I've also mentioned, you know, who those guys were that that you know were basically trimming the cards that I owned. So, you know, I want to be a guy that, you know, has a good reputation in the hobby, you know, that deals with everybody fair and square, and that, you know, that there aren't, you know, really any issues with. And at the same time, you know, like when unfortunate stuff like this happens, you know, I also don't want to be the guy that just says, oh, well, you know, I have XYZ amount of dollars in slabs, you know, so I'm just going to ignore it and pretend it doesn't happen. I mean, it's tough, you know, to walk both sides of the fence. I mean, like I still enjoy getting my cards graded. There's always a thrill of saying like, oh man, something came back and it was a nine or whatever, and you weren't sure. But at the same time, like, you know, the companies have to do better. I mean, what's really disappointing to me is the lack of response, you know, from any of them or all of them. And, you know, like, I just feel like they can do better to communicate with us. I mean, sometimes it feels like the silence almost feels like they're just kicking dirt on us a little bit and saying like, you know what, we just don't care. And, you know, and that's frustrating because I think I'm positive that they know how passionate we are as a collecting base. I mean, there are all these great podcasts, you know, that you guys are doing. I mean, there's so much incredible work, that all of you guys are doing to promote the hobby, you know, to get guest speakers, to talk about what guys and gals like, what they don't like, where, you know, I mean, and there's this information sharing that I think is really bringing the community together. You know, and then you weed out some of the bad players, but like, you know, like I feel like the grading company should work with us, and it almost feels like they're working against us. And if they would work with us, I think you could have a really harmonious, you know, industry that just, you know, not everybody has to love each other, but good gosh, I mean, like, we could all really grow together. And, you know, for the monetary perspective, I mean, there could be tons and tons of money that's available to be made for everybody. But then, like, you know, there's also just, you just feel better about what you're doing. And, you know, I do think that there are a lot of people out there with a lot of bad taste in their mouth. And, like, including myself, but at the same time, like, I just love it so much that I just don't see myself getting out of it per se.
Yeah. And I agree with you, Lou. I think, you know, sometimes that silence you mentioned is disheartening, like you said. You know, I think as a society, we're a forgiving society. If they would have just maybe got ahead of it a little bit more, hey, we know we had a couple bad employees that didn't that weren't above board. We're trying to clean that up. We're human. It happened. We're going to do everything in our powers to so this isn't a reoccurring theme, you know. And but you know they didn't. You know I don't want to get into, you know, Joe Orlando released a statement. I'm sure you heard it or read it, and it really was sort of like nothing to see here. It's more on you, or you know, it's and I thought like that was probably better to say nothing than even put that statement out. I thought it was more damning than damage control, you know. And like you said, it'd be nice if they you know were a little more proactive or said, hey, we're gonna do a few things differently. And it's more of just nothing to see here when there is things to see here, and they're just not really commenting on it. Obviously, you get counsel involved and legal. There's certain things they cannot say anymore. We know how that goes and that works. But, you know, I agree with you. It would be nice if they were a little bit more, you know, I don't expect them to admit guilt or anything like that, but at least some form of attrition, or hey, we got to do better. That's a little, you know, a little bit on us, and we're working towards that, you know, something. And they really did, in my mind, they really didn't.
No, I don't think I don't think you're alone. I mean, I certainly agree, and it's, I don't know. I mean, it's tough. To me, it's been frustrating. And,
yeah.
You know, I guess I'm used to, you know, like when you were saying that you're a Yankees fan and we were talking about.
I was when I was younger. I have to be honest, I'm a Mets fan current day. Steinbrenner kind of, you know, ruined it for me, and I kind of got off the Yankees bus. You know, that's a story in itself for another day, but yeah.
Well, I was only going to say that, you know, as it relates to, you know, like the TPGs and the, you know, the auction houses and you know, anybody that's involved, like, I always think of, you know, when you're talking about, like, just make a mea culpa or, like, a little apology, you know, the guy that stands out to me is Andy Pettit.
Like,
Andy Pettit, you know, got caught, you know, in the steroid scandal, and instead of hiding from it and holding like congressional hearings and this and that, basically he came up, called his own press conference, said, "Yes, I did it, and here's what happened." You know, he's like, "Look, the Yankees pay me like $15 million, $20 million a year to pitch, and I got hurt, and I felt like I was letting the team down, so I sought any and every method that I could to get back faster because we were in a pennant race."
Yeah.
And so he said what he did, and he took ownership for it. And, you know, now what? Andy Pettit walks around wherever he wants to go with his head held high. Nobody says anything to him about being a cheat.
Yeah.
And it is what it is.
Yeah.
You know, and then you got all these other guys, you know, who have taken, you know, the opposite approach. And, you know, now you got some high-end guys that may never get into the Hall of Fame anymore, you know, with like Bonds and Rose and Clemens. I mean, you know, the McGuires and Palmeiros, like, you know, just different things like that, all because, you know, they chose that other route, you know. And I think, I mean, like, there's nothing wrong with apologizing. Like,
yep. We're human.
Yeah, exactly. When you screw up, like, I mean, I just recently did a deal with a gentleman who's, you know, is a really nice guy. I mean, like, but we weren't seeing eye to eye on a couple of things, and, you know, and eventually he reached out to me for something, and we went back and forth, and then, long story short, we got the deal done, and, you know, we were like, look, it was a misunderstanding, and, you know, we sort of just, you know, kind of apologized, and what do they say, like, kissed and made up kind of thing, and now everything's good, and, you know, just this past weekend, you know, here in Nashville, we had this big show, and I did the deal with another guy who I actually only knew from Facebook interaction, and he's like, oh, you know, I would have never expected you, you know, to be like this, you know, just sort of really laid back. I was with my son. We made a really easy deal. You know, price was right and this and that. He's like, you're so vocal on Facebook and, you know, Instagram and, you know, whatever. And I'm like, well, you know, I said a lot of it is just, you know, just for fun, you know, like, you know, like engaging in dialogue and trying to get, bring people in to, you know, like, you know, have like a little, you know, kind of crap talking session around football or baseball or whatever players you like. And it's mostly, you know, not to get anybody, you know, mad or anything. It's just more of like, you know, just trying to bring out some personality and, you know, you get some more people engaged.
Yeah,
know,
stir
like
up a little emotion from folks.
Yeah, you know, so, you know, by the end of that conversation, you know, it was great. You know, we were laughing, and he's like, oh, man, I can't wait to, you know, to talk to a couple of my buddies about, you know, he's like, you know, about, like, who you really like and this and that. And I was like, man, you know, it's just funny how you can come off like that, so.
Yeah, sometimes perception's not always reality, and I think that's a great analogy you use, Lou, with Andy Pettit. You know, he got out kind of in front of it, you know, raised his hand, said, listen, here's what happened. I'm going to tell you, you know, after I tell you, it's going to be up to you how you want to view me, but this is why I did it, this is what happened, and my rationale. And people forgive him. You know, Mariano just got in the Hall of Fame, and who was in the crowd? You know, Jeter, him, and Posada all sitting next to each other. The camera panned, you know, multiple times over there. They commented on him. And, you know, frankly, they don't even really mention that anymore. And it's probably good, you know, for him that, you know, people, like I said, I think majority society is very forgiving if you kind of just have a little attrition. My bad. Here, I did it. I'm not going to lie about it. Here's why I did it. I might even not justify it, but this is what my mindset when it happened. And I'm sorry, and it is what it is, you know. And he's generally been forgiven, and probably rightfully so. And like you said, where the others have just kind of taken a different role, a road, you know. You got Palmeiro pointing his finger back at Congress, denying it, and then it's come out, you know, allegedly pretty obvious that he's not being, you know, all above board. And like you said, it's sad because, you know, those were obviously great players even without that enhancement. But the decisions they made and then the subsequent decisions afterward are going to prevent them from an accolade they probably should have and would have earned. And, you know, I thought it was a great analogy that you used that. And if you know, those grading companies maybe would have just said, hey, certain things happen. Not everything you're hearing is exactly true. We're cleaning stuff up, and you know, we apologize. We're human. Humans work here. Humans work in this building, and sometimes things may occur, and we're gonna try to you know, not have that happen again. I think that would have went, like you said, a long way. I interviewed Peter Steinberg from SGC at the National, and you know, I give him credit. He's a good businessman, and he really, you know, you know they've kind of navigated through those waters, and he struck and said, hey, we're really the only grading company right now that you can trust. And he told me, you know, I expect him to say it, but I tend to believe him that, you know, their business has never been higher. And so, you know, they've struck while the iron's hot, as they say, and you know, jumped on the opportunity to maybe get, you know, close that gap that's perceived there between them and Beckett and PSA. And you know, that's what happens. And smart on his case.
Yeah, I think I certainly think so. You know, as it relates to SEC, you know, to use this as an opportunity to, you know, promote their brand and say, hey, you know, we've only been minimally affected here, but yet they've owned the mistakes they've made. I mean, they had some autograph issues, you know, that were not too long ago. And you know, but what's interesting though is when they had their issues and that happened. I mean, that guy that, you know, the gentleman who, you know, made the mistake, I mean, he's no longer employed there. The decision was made, and then they, you know, they sort of changed up how they were going to do things, you know, and they issued, you know, a statement about it, you know, and subsequently have moved on. And I think that, you know, it's good that their business is growing. I mean, I've had this conversation with multiple people, and I think that, you know, it's almost like the, you know, American political system here in both in this country and in this particular industry. You know, to have a vibrant third party, I think, would help all of us quite a bit.
Yeah.
You know, like if the secondary market changes, you know, to some degree, you know, as time moves along here, and, you know, and if SGC starts and continues to, you know, achieve stronger prices, and, you know, instead of being, you know, say 50 cents on the dollar, they're like 75 cents on the dollar or more.
Yeah.
You know, as it relates to either Beckett or PSA, you know, then it will only help the hobby.
Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, we'll, not that we'll necessarily have fewer problems, but you have more solutions, and the more competition you have, you know, the pricing will go down, and it'll be better for all of us.
Yeah.
And the same thing would apply, you know, in politics. I mean, as far as, you know, the divisive rhetoric between the left and the right. I mean, there was a, you know, I don't want to necessarily say straight up the middle party, but whatever. I mean, whether it's independent or something in between, you know, it would be a lot better.
It would balance it out, like you said. You know,
so
more.
I root for SGC, you know, from, you know, in that, you know, from that perspective. And I do think that it would be, you know, certainly worthwhile. you know, for them to carve out a bigger role in the modern space. They do well in pre-war. They do well in vintage.
Yeah.
You know, and but then, you know, conversely, you know, Beckett has no exposure in pre-war. You know, their vintage, their vintage is nominal. I mean, they're barely a speck in the market.
Yeah.
But yet they're the dominant player in modern. So much so that they don't even care about the other spaces.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see how things evolve. But, you know, I think like just a little less arrogance, you know, I think would, you know, would help the hobby quite a bit.
Yeah. Yep, no doubt. Now, one last thing pertaining to this. How has it changed? What's happened? How has it changed what you do? Like, how would you say it's you know, from prior to this kind of making the big news that it has?
So, it's changed a lot. It has... I will really say that I'm grateful for the fact that I was able to get, you know, refunded through a couple of the auctions that I won through PWCC, and I'm grateful for the fact that one of the other Browns that I had, you know, I was through eBay and I had PayPal protection. But what I'm driving at, though, is that it's hurt my confidence in PSA Vintage, like, to the point where I will consider crossing to them, you know, if I have a card or if it's raw, but I'm scared, you know, to buy their cards in vintage holders, because what I don't want to have happen is, you know, if I do a transaction where I'm not protected, like the way that I happened to be, the last time, then, you know, I mean, you're talking about, I mean, it's just a lot of money. Like you can't, it's hard, you know, like, I mean, if I wasn't able to, you know, I've had those solutions available to me. I mean, like, how do you have that conversation with your wife being like, I screwed up and I lost $50,000.
I do that via text as I'm driving somewhere. So,
I mean, like, you know, it's one thing, like, if your stock market, you know, your stock portfolio goes down, you know, like,
out of your control.
They'll understand that, you know, but, like, you know, it's scary, you know, and that's something where I think that, you know, I do hope that, you know, this message, you know, gets to the leadership of all the companies, and, you know, that they'll understand, you know, what is now going through, you know, their customers' minds.
I mean, well, what I tend to do, not to, you know, cut you off, Lou, is anyone that's mentioned, you know, during the show or during the broadcast, I tend to tag them. So I will, you know, if they want to hear, you know, what's being said by both of us, no doubt. And you know, I think it's fair. You know, I've been on the show, and I always use the word allegedly. I try to believe in, you know, innocent before guilty. But you know, I've had some strong statements and strong opinions. But I've always followed them with, if I've said something about you and you don't agree with it or you want to refute it, I believe you have the opportunity to get a hold of me and say, hey, I want to be on the show next week. I want to talk about what you said and tell everyone it's baloney or whatever. And I've always said that. So if anyone, you know, individually or company-wise, you know, doesn't agree with something, they're more than welcome. I know, you know, generally that's not going to happen when there's counsel involved, and I understand why. But if they so choose, you know, especially individually wise, anyone's more than welcome to say, hey, I heard what you said. And, you know, that's how I'd want to be treated. If someone said, you know, John did this or John did that, and, you know, and it wasn't true, and it's on the public airwaves, regardless of who listens, I'd like an opportunity to say, hey, you know, you said this, and I'm here to tell you it's a bunch of phooey, you know, and. I've always been like that. I believe in equal time, and you know, I'd love for one of those parties to you know, take me up on that offer. I don't expect it; it hasn't happened. But you know, I'll tag them, and you know, whether they listen or not, that's on them. But I believe they, you know, it's important, like you said, to get that clarity and maybe, you know, to grow and make improvements going forward so that that confidence can be regained. I don't think it's impossible. It's difficult. You've said yourself you're a little gun shy after that and deservedly so. You don't have to apologize for that, no doubt. I think, and I'm sure you're not the only one, and they should be concerned about that, because that, you know, I know business is not hurting for them. PSA just had their one of their best quarters, and but you can't look at that and say, well, we don't need, you know, we don't care about, you know, so and so and one person, because those masses can add up, so they really need to see the big picture.
Yeah, needless to say, I agree with all that, and you know, I think it's critical to sort of say that I think we're both very pro the hobby, the industry, and all of the iterations that have come, you know, since we were, you know, 10, 12 years old, like when we started off the conversation. Yep. to where we are now. I mean, it's wonderful. And there's so many different unique ways to, you know, share the hobby with, you know, with friends and, you know, and make new friends and acquaintances, you know, through mm-hmm. social media and the interconnectivity of it. And, you know, it doesn't have to be a bash fest. I mean, like, nope. You know, my comments aren't, you know, like, oh, I can't stand SGC or I can't stand Beckett or PSA. It's just like, look, you know, there's what's happened has hurt, yep. You know, a fair number of people. And, you know, like you said, I have to say, I mean, I'm just very appreciative of, you know, the way that PWCC took care of me and the way that, you know, the protections that you have through eBay and PayPal, you know, otherwise, you know, this conversation, you know, wouldn't have sort of a, you know, a no consequence to it. But, you know, like you said, hopefully at some point, you know, when counsel can relax, you know, maybe these guys will come out, you know, and be able to, you know, sort of illustrate, okay, here's exactly what was true, you know, here are the things that weren't true,
yeah,
and these are the changes that have been made, you know, for the betterment for all of us.
Yeah.
You know, because you can see the growth is there, the enthusiasm is there, the money pouring into the hobby is there, so there's lots and lots of great momentum, you know, and the shows are packed, and so, I mean, that in and of itself is exciting. I mean,
yeah.
I love it, and you know, and I'm also, like I said before, I mean, I'm extremely appreciative of the research and the dedication, you know, of the blowout guys.
Yeah.
For everything that they've done. I mean, I mean, good gosh, you know, I don't know, you know, how many other people, you know, that you've spoken to that, you know, have been, you know, maybe as affected as I have been, or have started to tell their stories, but there's gotta be a bunch out there.
Yeah.
You know, and now it's like, well, what do you do about it? So hopefully, you know, that, you know, for the collectors inside of, you know, the heads of these companies, you know, or just even like the, you know, even the heads of the products, you know, the products of the companies and things like that, like, there's got to be something inside of them that says, like, yeah, we can do better, and here's what we're going to do, and, you know, let's clean it up and let's move forward. I mean,
yep.
You know, what's happening here is not unique, you know, to just our industry.
Nope.
I mean, this goes on in all the industries, but you can't just bury your head.
Yeah. Well, I've said on this show, if there's money to be made, and you nailed it with that last statement, in any industry, there's going to be unscrupulous activity, whether it be Wall Street or the housing market, or in this case, you know, the hobby and the card market. If someone can gain an advantage, and even if it's illegal, if they can make profit off it and line their bank accounts with it, it's going to occur, or it's going to be attempted, you know, whether it occurs or not, it's going to be attempted. And it's, like you said, it's not relegated just to sports cards. It's in any industry, in any market. And it is what it is. I mean, like you said, you can't bury your head in the sand. We can't act like, you know, I've said I honestly don't really like talking about it. I rather talk about something more positive, and I do a lot of times. But at the same time, you can't act like it didn't happen and not be informative about it either, because if you don't, it'll just potentially keep occurring, you know. And hopefully, you know, some change comes. Maybe, like you said, you know, when things progress and you know, there's rumors that the feds are looking at maybe potential charges and indictments, and when that stuff maybe finally comes to fruition, maybe the truth will come out. Maybe when the truth comes out, you know, some might argue, Lou, that, well, that's too late. You know, they had to wait till, you know, they got their hands caught in the cookie jar, then they talk. But if that's what it takes for them to maybe admit some things, you know, that they were wrong on, and like you said, here's what we're going to do to try to ensure that this never occurs again. Better, you know, like they say, better late than never. So maybe, you know, we just have to wait till some of this stuff really comes to a head, whatever that head takes form of, whether that's court cases and charges and that sort of thing, if that occurs. And, you know, the rumor is there was 22 subpoenas issued at the National. I don't believe they're doing that. You know, some might argue that was more for aesthetics or for show. I tend to think not, that there's money and manpower that goes behind that. I don't think they're going to do that just for, you know, ruffling their feathers like a peacock. I think there's substance there. They're looking into the stuff. I think they're building their case. And I think that's, you know, it's gotten a little quiet, and I think that's kind of why. So, we'll, you know, obviously we have to take a wait and see approach, and that's all you can do, and see, you know, what kind of shoe drops next.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have much to add in terms of the speculation of what is or isn't, but, you know, I just think that the wheels of justice tend to turn slow, and, you know, patience will be a virtue to see, you know, what, if anything, happens, and then ultimately, again, what's deserved, and you know, we'll just have to see how it goes. But I do think that now is a good time to, you know, just to kind of continue to mention that, you know, I'm hoping, you know, that between all the positives that are going on, you know, with respect to momentum and, you know, everything that's going on, you know, good in the hobby, as well as this bad stuff, is that I'm hoping that you recognize that there's a huge space here for what you do, you know, with the podcast and, you know, Drew and Josh from Cardboard Chronicles, and, you know, I mean, the list just goes on and on and on. Yep. And I'm really excited, you know, to continue to listen, you know, to what the content that you guys are all putting out. I think it's extremely important, and the knowledge that I've gained, you know, just from listening and, you know, in some cases watching it's just been, you know, sort of industry changing for me, you know, and you know, how I think about, you know, who I want to do business with, and, yep, you know, what other products do I want to look at, you know, where there's opportunity, you know, to invest, if you will. So I hope that, you know, you guys will just continue to thrive and put out more and more content, and, you know, just, you know, get us, continue to get the guests on and talk about the things that are substantive, you know, within what's going on, because I think there's a lot of people that do want to talk about it.
Yeah.
And I think they will over time.
So, yeah, I think,
you know, I'd love to see you guys all collaborate and just and just continue to put it out there. There's so much good stuff.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, I've said this on the show. I don't like the report. Unless there's a new wrinkle, I don't like just to beat a dead horse. And you know, if something new arises with the negative stuff, I'll talk about it. You know, with you having you on, I know you were affected by it, so I wanted your perspective on it. That's why, you know, we broached that subject. But normally, unless something really new occurs, I try not to harp on it. I think, again, another thing you said that I agree wholeheartedly with, I think more people will talk about it that are involved as time kind of moves on. I think there's people, you know, probably scared to, you know, what do I do here? I want to talk, but I can't. I'm being told not to, and so you know, you forget, like, with stuff like this, it's not just the one person that's affected. It's, you know, they have families involved too, and it puts a negative connotation on more than just one person. And so I'm sure that's where some of that mindset is. But like you said, you know, it's a great way to kind of come to, you know, there's a lot more great stuff than this, and that's where we really need to kind of keep moving forward. You know, your collection and you're a positive force in the hobby. That's why I wanted to have you on. You're an intelligent guy. I wanted your perspective on not just that, but everything, the hobby in general. So I'm going to give you, like I always give the guests, kind of the final word, Lou. Where can people see the incredible inventory you have, get a hold of you, and see, you know, Sports Card Exchange?
I appreciate that, John. Yeah, I mean, if anybody's, you know, interested in getting together and talking cards and, you know, potentially doing some deals, I have a website that is sportscardexchange.com. I'm also Sports Card Exchange on Instagram and Sports Card X on Twitter. And, you know, to leave it on a very high-end positive, I do think that, that the collectors and the hobbyists should really be excited about the really cool auctions that have been going on over the last 3-4 months. I mean, there's been some really great pieces and prices hitting all types of records, Golden and Heritage and PWCC and Probstein and Mile High, Leland's, I mean, REA. I mean, there's just been massive piece after massive piece. So, you know, that's the excitement level, you know, that I have about the optimism going forward. So I think between, you know, being able to talk to you and I and all the different guys that are putting out content, you know, that just gives me so much excitement and optimism for the future that, you know, I think the next 5 to 10 years, you know, will be really exciting for all of us.
Yeah, no doubt. I think the good outweighs the bad. It's not even close. And I think, you know, that balance will shift back, you know, eventually. I think it's already, like you mentioned, I think it already is trending that way. And, you know, it's still a great hobby with great people. You know, the tagline of the show is the hobby is the people. And there's a lot of great people like yourself. And that's what makes the hobby what it really is. And so I appreciate you coming on, Lou, giving us this time. And I think people really will appreciate the perspective that you brought today.
Well, John, again, I really appreciate you reaching out, and you know, the opportunity to speak to your audience is one that I was super excited about and took seriously. So, you know, hopefully, you know, if anybody reaches out to you privately, you know, you can certainly let them know that, you know, I was agreeable to talking about any and all content, because it's an exciting time. It's a little bit of a nervous time, but I think if we stick together, you know, there's a lot of good things that can happen. And, you know, let's try to keep that dialogue going, you know, I don't know. I you know, you could really build a long-term bullish case for the hobby, you know, based on the amount of, like you said, the amount of really good people that are coming in and doing really great work. And also, and even, like you said, even on the detective side of things, it's just been awesome, you know, that those guys thought enough of for the rest of us, saying, like, look, the amount of hours and time and skill that it took for those guys to, you know, to put all this together to to help bring attention to, you know, some irregularities and, you know, just some, you know, borderline, you know, you don't want to get into like the actual verbiage of it, but the activity that is not good. And, you know, I just want to let those guys know I'm thankful for that as well.
Yeah. And it's, and, you know, it's nice that there's watchdogs like that out there doing that, like you said, because, you know, sometimes that's the deterrent in itself, is that someone who's even thinking about maybe doing something that's not above board is just like, hey, there's just so many people checking this stuff and cross-referencing stuff. I'm not going to do it. Maybe that's what it takes to deter it. And if it is, so be it. That's the end goal, is you want more, you know, things to be above board. And if it takes people, you know, turning over stones and looking at things to get to that point, then that's a positive, like you just said.
Yep. Well, I think that's a good place to leave it. Johnny, you're doing great work, brother. I'm really eager to, you know, to hear what you guys continue to put out, because you're really helping a lot of us, you know, that really love this hobby. So I'm appreciative, you know, as a consumer of your content, and obviously a lover of the industry.
Yep. Well, I appreciate those kind words. I'd love to have you back on, and we won't talk about that. We'll talk about just all other stuff on a future podcast and an episode.
Anytime you want me, I'll be happy to come on.
All right. I'm gonna hold you to that, Lou. Hey, thank you again. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you, John. Take care, everybody.
We love our listeners. Without you, there is no us. We care about your opinions and feedback and invite you to reach out to us on any of our social media accounts. On Instagram, at Sports Card Nation Podcast. Twitter, at Sports Card NATI1. Or email the show at sportscardnationpc@gmail.com. We don't ask for much, but if you really like the show, give us a shout out. Tell your friends or give us a follow on our social medias. If you enjoy the show, please give us a positive review on iTunes or any of the platforms you are listening on. Thank you.
It's time for From the Box Seats, where we go around the world of sports. We'll start in baseball. We have the Braves Cards series with going the full five, and the Cards explode in the first inning in Game 5, and they're going to advance. That was a surprise, not in so much that they won, although I did think the Braves were going to win, but in the fashion that they won Game 5 was disappointing. I know Braves fans are probably disappointed, but that team's very young. They're going to be in the mix probably for the next 3-5 years, if not longer, so I wouldn't hang my head's for too long. So they'll take on the Washington Nationals, because the Nationals shocked the Dodgers and Dave Roberts' bulk. Not necessarily saying it's Dave Roberts' fault, but I'm not a big fan. I think he's overrated as a manager. I think me and you can coach that lineup and pitching staff to an NL West title. And again, they're always like the bridesmaid, they're never the bride here, as they always get to that first round, but they can't close this out. So this is very disappointing for Dodger fans. And, you know, as dominant as Clayton Kershaw is in the regular season, here's another circumstance where in the postseason he just struggles mightily.
I had one job to do, was get 3 outs, and got 1 out, and didn't get the other 2, and they went over the fence, cost us the game right there. So that's a terrible feeling. You know, there's no excuses. Just didn't make pitches, and guy hit it over the fence twice. So.
I might be one of the few, but I feel bad for Clayton Kershaw. This is just, you know, some of this you got to just chalk up to being very unlucky. You know, obviously he knows how to pitch. He's a dominant pitcher, but in the regular season, I don't know if the tension gets to him. It was tough, you know, seeing him in the dugout after that game, kind of sitting by himself for an extended period of time. you know, you heard a part of that soundbite, but he also went on to basically say that he stinks and he's living up to the, you know, bad in the playoffs billing, you know, being very hard on himself, a little disappointed. I'm not a Dodger fan, obviously, but, you know, it's clips of people throwing the Kershaw jerseys back on the field. There's another clip of people running it over with their car in the parking lot or on the road. And, you know, I understand, you know, I've been there as fans of teams. You're frustrated. You're upset. You know, I think for the Dodgers, it was World Series or bust. So you bust it out and you're disappointed and you're, in your mind and probably in the Dodgers front office mind, it's season overall was probably would be considered a failure. But, you know, this is still one of the faces of your franchises. First ballot Hall of Famer. Yes, I know the postseason numbers haven't matched the regular season numbers, but to see fans do that to his jersey and stuff, I know where it's coming from. I get it, but I just think that's extreme. But you know that a lot of high hopes were dashed with the Dodgers being defeated. So now you got Cardinals, Nationals. I don't think a lot of people picked them. I think a lot of people picked the Braves and the Dodgers to be at this point. So in a way, you got sort of two upset series here, you know, and it's just the other irony, you know, Bryce Harper signs with the Phillies, has a press conference, says he can't wait to bring a championship to Washington, when he meant to say Philadelphia, and Philadelphia did not make the playoffs and are eliminated, and Washington's still in there. So they lose Harper, and they're in the NLCS, and Bryce Harper is home watching that. You know, the irony's not lost on me. It's not lost on a lot of other people. And sometimes money can't buy you postseason success, and apparently that's going to cost Gabe Kapler his job, as he was let go of his duties from the Phillies. So it'll be interesting to see if and where he lands. There's some people who don't really think he's a great manager, so it'll be interesting to see if someone gives him a chance. The Mets have an opening. I'll be honest with you, I don't want Gabe Kapler, so I'm hoping they get Joe Girardi. Speaking of firings, let's go to the NFL. Another coach is unemployed there. It's Gruden. Not John Gruden, but rather Jay Gruden. Missed Captain Partier, but, you know, just winless Redskins team. Kind of rudderless at quarterback. He reluctant to play Haskins and didn't play him much, and I think there was friction there. Then the video surfaced of Jay Gruden basically, you know, drinking and smoking and, you know, partying like he's in college again, and even saying a comment that he's going to get fired. I just think it was too much for Dan Snyder to overlook, and so Jay Gruden is out. It'd be interesting to see if he winds up with the Raiders and his brother. That's probably what I'm going to predict will happen. How soon, I don't know. On the trade market, you know, we talked on last episode that there's a lot more trades in the NFL than there ever used to be, and now there's two big names rumored to be on the trade block at the wide receiver position, A.J. Green in Cincinnati, although the Bengals are denying that's the case, and OBJ already looking like he might be wearing out his welcome in Cleveland, is rumored to be, Cleveland's rumored to be listening to trade offers for him, you know, with Watchgate, and you know, the thing about him, it's always been like he's a me guy, and you know, they're not happy with the watch thing because it's like, instead of worrying about winning games, he's worried about wearing his watch and running routes. So two guys might be on the move, both playing in the state of Ohio with the OBJ in Cleveland and AJ Green in Cincinnati. Hopefully you got in our World Series giveaway contest that we're running on Twitter. It is closed now, so too late to get in, but you were one entry per person, and you were to pick a team you thought was going to win the World Series. I can tell you a lot of Braves were picked and a lot of Dodgers were picked. So, but the real heavy favorite, even in the contest, was the Astros. So many are still alive as the Astros do advance tonight to the ALCS. It'll be Astros-Yankees, and that should be an interesting series as well. So it's Astros-Yankees, Nats-Cardinals, with the winners of each league advancing to the World Series. One of One Card Shop offers a tremendous breaking experience, great customer service, and they're constantly pulling fire. Steve and his family take care of you like one of their own and treat you right. Anyone can break, but no one treats you like one of one. Come check them out on Instagram at @one_of_one_card_shop. For all the hot breaks, get a gold mailer headed your way. So that concludes another episode of the Sports Car Nation podcast. As always, I want to thank you for listening to the show, spreading the word if you do that. If you like the show, we always like positive reviews. I just recently got a review where the reviewer gave us a 5 out of 5 and said, John has a great beard. I posted something on social media. So there's a first for that. I'm glad you like my beard. My beard thanks you as well. My beard couldn't be here today. No, actually it is. But my beard thanks you. Thank you for the 5-star rating for my beard. Maybe the beard should have its own show or even its own Twitter page. Maybe we should make a John's Beard Twitter. But all joking aside, you know, we thank you for listening. You like the show. We love positive reviews. We like feedback. You know, something not your cup of tea, you know, send us a message. Let us know what you want to hear, maybe what you want to hear less, that sort of thing. And we definitely appreciate the feedback. We're not going to bite your head off, especially when I'm telling you to give it to us. I want to thank Lewis Popper Jr. today. Great interview. It was really enjoyable. They, you know, all my interviews are always enjoyable for me, but you know, having him on today was definitely enlightening, and you know, to be that candid about, you know, being personally affected by some of the negative stuff in the hobby. A lot of other people are and probably wouldn't want you to advertise it and put themselves out there like that, and he did, and I appreciate it. You know, he's got, again, quite the collection. Check him out if follow him if you don't already. Just insane, the stuff that he has, and very smart when it comes to this hobby. And again, we appreciate him coming on. A little sneak peek to episode 46 next week. My guest will be Ken Kinsley of Beans Ball Card Blog. And Ken, I've talked to a little bit even before the show. He's one of my favorites. This is a guy who says what he feels. He doesn't mince words. I love it. We need more of that. He's gonna bring the takes next week for sure. I know that, no doubt, because that's the way he is. He's a great blog writer, great content producer. Even just following him, if you just follow him on Twitter, he's definitely not short of opinions. You know, some people call him opinionated. I just call him a straight shooter. And I you know, if I may be so bold, I put myself pretty much in that category as well. So he's going to be on the show next week. We got a couple guests lined up coming up. I don't want to give too much away. We have a very important show with two very important guests coming up, I believe, on episode 48. It does have cards in the backstory, in the base story, but it's more than cards, and I'm really looking forward to that as well, because, you know, life is a very important part of the hobby too, and we're going to talk a little bit about that. I don't want to mention them by name yet, but soon enough I will. So as always, I want to thank everyone for making this show really what it's really come as we approach the 1 year mark. It's crazy. We're approaching episode 50. We're going to give away $50 cash, maybe some other stuff. We've got a Gary V Topps 360 autograph box set. Where Gary V signed the outside of the box. I got it in Chicago. I'm going to give that away as a giveaway, as well as a future episode as we go along. So we got a lot of big stuff planned, and you know, with between sponsorships and other things, things are pretty good. So again, thank you. I'm going to let my man Marlon Carlson play us out. Sparty Hawk, some of you may know him by. Trying to get him on the program. He's a little resistant. Going to have to threaten him, I think, with bodily harm. But he'll be on the show, and at least in this form, as he plays us out. Thanks, everyone. We'll see you next week.
You've been listening to the Sports Card Nation podcast. Join host John Newman next week as he gives you another jam-packed episode of all things related to the sports card hobby. And a little extra fun, too. Don't forget to check out the show on Instagram at Sports Card Nation Podcast.